then the thing I want to talk about next is talk about, we've talked about light and, you know, what are the castings required, but now let's talk about LED technology. And I want to touch upon four things. One is, how does it actually work? How do we get light out of LED? How do we package it? And it's also a forward bias diode, and that requires a lot goes into actually how you control the bias and how you drive this LED. So I want to talk about that a little bit. So typically, you know, the LEDs you get in these small packages that you might have used in a e-lab or so, those typically look like this. You have a cathode and an anode, and your LED is actually that piece of gallium nitride is mounted on a very small dish, which is again metal, and it is used to act as a heat sink also. And that package, the whole purpose is to get maximum light out of that chip into your atmosphere, and that typically has a refractive index, which is intermediary between the air and your substrate material. So anti-reflective coating, again, which we talked about solar, it works both ways. So if you have a light coming in, it helps that light to get in. But you have light coming in from inside. If you have a intermediate, if you have a material in between, which has an intermediate refractive index between your semiconductor and the atmosphere, it also helps that light to get out. So it works both ways. If anything works in trapping the light, it also helps the light to escape as well. So the material set which is needed for RGB is essentially determined by increasing amount of band gap. So most of the R is typically done by gallium arsenide or aluminum gallium arsenide based material. And then for yellow and green, people use gallium phosphide or a mixture of gallium phosphide with aluminum or indium. And these have been around for a while. People knew how to make LEDs on gallium phosphide and gallium arsenide in the 70s and 80s. What was missing was the blue part of it, which is needed to complete this gamut. And that happened in the late 90s with the invention of this person, Shuji Nakamura, who he did actually two main things. He perfected the MOCVD process of gallium nitride. So as we heard in Monday as well, that gallium nitride does not have a crystal. No matter, there's no easy way. You can't use a Cherkassky growth or a zone refining process to make a crystal out of gallium nitride. It's just not stable, and it's very brittle. So people typically try to grow it on sapphire, which is aluminum oxide, and you get defect densities of. When he started to work on it, the defect densities were around 10 to power 11 or 10 to power 10, and he brought it down by 2 orders of magnitude using his MOCVD process, and that's still used by Nichia, and they're still the number one player in LEDs because of this MOCVD process. And the other thing which was missing was, for an LED you need a P-type and an N-type material. So people knew how to make N-type gallium nitride, but it was very difficult to make P-type gallium nitride. So he figured out that, you know, it was due to hydrogen that that material was not turning P-type, and very simple bake which removes the hydrogen could actually make it P-type. And because of these two main things, he was able to invent the blue LED. This was one of the first chips that he made, and again, it's a very simple chip. It's grown on this aluminum oxide sapphire substrate, and then you have a thick buffer of gallium nitride, and then you have indium gallium nitride, which is a smaller band gap, and then P gallium nitride on the top. And since sapphire is essentially aluminum oxide, it's semi-insulating, or it's an insulator. You cannot have a bottom contact, so you need to make your both top and bottom both your cathode and anode on your substrate itself. So you have to etch it out and make another contact, and both of them have to be top contact essentially. And this is from his original paper in 1995, where he showed the blue LED. And so you know, this shows the progress map of LEDs, both red, blue, and green. So the blue really arrived in 1995, and since then their efficiency have been increasing, but it kind of saturated again around 2000. And now there has been some recent progress, again made by the same guy, where he again invented a few things. He got rid of polar planes, and we heard more about it on Monday. So now that roadmap again has started going up. It's compared over here with respect to some of the incumbents. So incandescent bulb, as you can see, has a maximum efficacy of around 10 or 20. Fluorescent bulb goes about 80. The best HID lamp goes up to 140. So the LEDs currently are above fluorescent, but slightly lower than your discharge-based lamp. So this is you know, very simple device physics. So people are used to diode by this equation, but this is essentially your forward bias current. This doesn't give you any light. The part which gives you light is this recombination generation current. And if you have a simple PN diode, you actually get a lot of this forward bias current and way less of this recombination generation current. So what people do is essentially you play band engineering tricks to increase your recombination generation. So what is typically done is a quantum well or a layer which has a smaller band gap with respect to your PNN layers is introduced there. And this does two purposes. It actually makes your recombination generation more efficient because you have this local source of both electrons and holes available. And the other thing it does is, if you simply have a PN junction, if you emit a photon, there's a large probability that, you know, it will get reabsorbed either in your P or N layer before it's emitted out. But if you have this quantum well, you now emit a photon which has an energy which is less than the band gap of your PNN layer. So it's not reabsorbed back in your LED. So it achieves both these purposes if you have a quantum well in between. And people typically have more than one quantum well because they again want to minimize that forward bias current which just grows from your P to N without recombining. So what you want to ensure is give your carriers, both your electrons and holes, multiple chances that they can recombine before they escape out. So you have these multiple quantum wells in your stack. And typically you have around 3 to 5. If you have a laser, you have much more, of course. But 3 to 5 is what is gives you the maximum. If you're going above that, it's really an overkill. And the wavelength also, to some extent, can be tuned by both the stoichiometry of this material that you're making the quantum well from, and also the width of this quantum well. So especially if you make it small, you can again make it more slightly higher in band gap. So the actual band diagram, especially for your nitride based LEDs, the quantum wells, you know, they don't look like these nice symmetric quantum wells shown over here. In reality, they look something like this. So the quantum wells have a lot of spikes in between. So this is an actual band diagram. You can see that, you know, your quantum wells aren't straight like that. They have spikes like this. So does anybody know why you have spikes, especially if you have gallium nitride based LEDs? So gallium nitride is a polar material, right? and indium gallium nitride is also a polar material. So when two of these polar materials form a heterojunction, you get a local electric field at the interface. And because of that, you have, you know, whenever you form a heterojunction, you get very strong electric field at that interface, and you get these spikes in your band gap instead of getting those nice quantum wells. And this is one of the reasons which actually limits the efficiency also. And more recently, Nakamura has been able to get rid of these polar planes and use non-polar plane, and that gives further improvement. If you have more structured and no spikes in your quantum wells, that further increases your efficiency. Because these spikes in electric field, they tend to force those carriers out or make these quantum wells not as efficient for trapping light. So again, the way we generate, the most common way of generating white from blue is to strike it on phosphorus. So you get two peaks essentially. You get one peak which is from the LED, and then you get this broad peak which looks like a black body radiation, and that's from phosphorus. The downside of this is you get better color response, but the downside is you do get a lot of Stokes locks. That is, you're essentially down converting a high energy photon into a low energy photon, into a black body radiation off a low energy photon. So all that down conversion loss is what is called as Stokes loss. And you know, that is one of the disadvantages of doing this phosphorus coating based approach. But again, due to the nature of the way our human vision is, in terms of color, this does appear to be a good way to achieve color using a single light source. So the other thing which is very important and actually limits the efficiency of your overall system is the total internal reflection. So these LED materials, gallium nitride, for example, has a refractive index of 2.4. Gallium phosphide has even higher, it has a refractive index of 3.5. So what it means is that your light from if it's a point source, if it tries to come out, it will be only able to come out in this area of this cone. Whatever is outside this area of the cone will essentially be above your critical angle, and it will not be able to escape escape out of the semiconductor. And all those photons will again be reflected back in. Many of them will actually go, some of them can get reabsorbed, or they won't be able to get out. So this essentially limits how much of your light you can get out. So this is for a point source. For an actual LED where your recombination is happening in all over the place, this is even more complex. And you have multiple of these cones, and whatever from each of these sources, only that light in that particular cone can get out of your system. So people play a lot of tricks to to overcome this problem. But we need to understand that, you know, whatever light is generated, either it's not able to come out because of total internal reflection. A lot of that light, if it's not able to come out and it goes back into those quantum wells, it can get reabsorbed. And then you have these two LEDs, which are your contacts coming, especially there's a contact coming in from that top. So whatever that thickness of that wire is, that's again blocking the light from coming out. And each of these limit your efficiency of which you can extract your generated photons. And those numbers typically, at best, people are able to get 80% of the light out. And that also, they have to play a lot of tricks. So the tricks people play is, you know, first of all, they put this in a high index plastic. So your package is typically made of a refractive index, which is somewhere in between 2.4 and 1. So if it has to be ideal, it has to be geometric mean of 2.4 if it's a gallium nitride based LED. And the other thing they do is the substrate itself, they make it thick and and such that you have multiple surfaces available. So so your light can come out of all of these surfaces, and that can improve the total light which comes out by how many number of surfaces you have. At maximum, you can have 6. So the schemes that people use are very similar to what we discussed in solar. So one of the most common schemes where it is used is to make this gallium nitride layer thin. At the same time, make that top surface very rough. So what it does is, again, when your light is generated, it does not have too much volume of gallium nitride to get reabsorbed in. At the same time, if you make that surface rough, that light, when it hit, it can hit at an angle which is, you know, more normal, and it has more probability of getting out. But in principle, if you look from the processing point of view, all these schemes look very similar to solar. But they are, in fact, achieving the reverse effect. They are helping to get the light out instead of trapping the light. And that is a lot of it has to do because light is being generated inside the cell instead of light being coming out and light being absorbed. So a lot of these schemes and these techniques, they work both ways. What's used for solar is, again, very useful for LEDs. So another trick which is used is to use this corrugated sapphire substrate. So instead of having a plain sapphire substrate, you have it with these spikes. And again, that helps to send out these lights in all these different angles so it can get out of your system. The other scheme which is used is this flip chip packaging. And this is, again, very similar to what we discussed, flip chip bonding using inner chips, and also that backside illumination. So what it, again, involves is that you want to minimize the loss because of that wire on the top contact. So you place your contacts to both P and N on the bottom instead of the top. So that top surface is, again, kept very pristine, so the light can get out without any shadowing from the from the wire on the top. And this was invented by Philips, and it's, again, used pretty routinely nowadays. And the way you can identify that if you use a chip which has flip chip versus non-flip chip, you'll see one which has a wire coming in, versus one which has no wire coming in from the top.